Did you know that number lines should not be used before second grade? Are you like, say what? Right? Because number lines are very prevalent in kindergarten and first grade classrooms. However, it's actually recommended that in kindergarten and first grade, we instead use number paths. I'm Christina Tondevold, the recovering traditionalist. I hope you'll stick around as we investigate how to use a number path in our quest to help us build our math minds so we can build the math minds of our students. So first off, let's talk about what is a number path. There's so many times when I say that and people are like, I've never even heard of a number path. So what is it? A number path is just isolated objects in a path that allows kids to count things. A number line is a wonderful tool, and you've probably seen some of my last posts that are all about the power of number lines. But for our young kiddos, a number line is actually a length-based model. You're counting the length of something. Our young kids need something to count, not just the length, not a measurement. So a number path helps our kids to see the objects in a line and be able to count individual objects instead of having to count a length, which is weird to have to count for our young kiddos. So if you've ever seen a kid struggle with number lines, it's because there's not a thing to count. When they do count, they end up counting the little tick marks on the number line instead of the length between those tick marks. So they'll often, if they're trying to add or subtract on a number line, they will often be incorrect because there's not a thing to count. So a number path gives our students something to count because in kindergarten and first grade, they're still in that direct modeling or counting on phase that I've talked a lot about, and they need something to count. Now, the first place that I ever realized that I shouldn't be using number lines was, oh man, this is probably really gonna date me, but quite a few years ago, our state was in the process of reviewing our math standards and trying to come up with better standards. Well, during that time, and I was on that team of teachers who was investigating our standards and trying to decide, is this a good standard? What else do we need? Does this standard go to a different grade level? All of that kind of stuff. Well, about after our first or second meeting, that is when the original talk of the Common Core standards came about. And so our job as this group became not one of creating the standards, but it became very prevalent that our state was pretty much going to adopt the Common Core. And so our state wanted us to review those and give feedback to the writers of the Common Core state standards of what we thought. So one of the things that I remember seeing was a line in one of those very first original documents of Common Core standards that said, number lines should not be used before second grade. And I started questioning it. What are you talking about? It's like in every kindergarten and first grade classroom, people are using number lines because kids need those. So I started digging, and it took me a while, but I found a couple books that talked about it, and they're called Focus from the NCTM. There's Focus in kindergarten, Focus in first grade, Focus in second grade. There's one for each grade level, but it was all about teaching with the curriculum focal points. These were before Common Core ever came about. There you go. Is that our National Council of Teachers of Mathematics put together their focal points. These were the major standards that we really needed to focus in on at each grade level. And so those books talked about what are those focal points and how do we do it? How do we teach those concepts? And both of those, the kindergarten and the first grade book, talk about number paths. And they have an image similar to this. This image shows how a number path gives kids a count model instead of a length-based model. And it's not to say that that length-based model is bad. Kids need it. It's just a little too abstract for our young kids in kindergarten and first grade. So that brings me to the second piece that I want to mention, which is where the number path fits in this CRA model. If you've heard me talk about that before, that is the concrete to representational to abstract. Now, one thing I just forgot. Don't forget, underneath this video, if you don't have NumberPass, if you've never used NumberPass before, there's a link to be able to download my version of a NumberPath that goes up to 20. There's also, you can buy them on my website. I created the document at first for the teachers that I worked with because there was nowhere where you could get NumberPass. So I created a document, and then the teachers would say, well, can I buy these somewhere? So I have them specially made that has a coating on them that kids can write on them with whiteboard markers, and then they can just wipe it right off. It's they're a wonderful thing to be using in your classroom. So there's a link to just download it and use it however you want, or if you want the pre-made ones that come with the special coating, you can go to my website, buildmathminds.com, or if you're on the blog, there's a link up above that says shop, and you can go to my shop and there's the number path there. All right, so let's dig into where the number path fits on the CRA model. So again, CRA stands for concrete to representational to abstract. Concrete is when children are actually physically touching, moving objects around. So if you have manipulatives, that's when they're working in the concrete phase. They're counting out six things. That's concrete. Representational is when they're drawing a representation of those six things. Now, the hard part with our young kids is that they will draw very intricate drawings. If we are talking, if the story is about six teddy bears, they want to draw the teddy bears and color the teddy bears and make sure that the teddy bears have ears and eyes and, you know, all the details. But really, we want kids to not have to get bogged down in drawings and instead use models. I talk to the kids all the time about using a model in mathematics, not a drawing. There's a time when we want intricate drawings, but there's a time when we just want a model. And a number path is a great model for students to use. And so a number path falls in the representational phase. And then abstract is when they just have the digit. So if they just have the digit six, that's very abstract. You don't see six things there. So the reason, again, that number paths are better, if we look at the difference between them again, there's the number path has the six individual things that kids can see. They can see each object there. In a number line, it's still a representation, but it becomes more abstract because where are the six things on a number line? It's not obvious to our young kids. The six things is actually the six lengths in between the tick marks. And that's hard for our young kiddos to see visually. So the number line is still a representation, but it's more abstract. So the number path is a more concrete representation than a number line is. It's still a representation, but it's falling more towards a concrete representation for our students. Okay. All right, so let's talk about my two favorite ways to use a number path. How do we actually use a number path? Well, one of my favorite ways is to help our kiddos build number sense. For a lot of our students, when they think of six, the only thing they think of is the digit six. We want them to picture six things, okay? So let's say I give the number path to a student and I say circle seven. Most often, the number one way that we see kids circle seven is they just circle where the seven is. And so there are definitely ways I could rephrase that to make it more obvious, but I just want to put it out there to see what they do, what they think of when they think of seven. So oftentimes we get it where they just circle the digit, where the digit seven is. But in reality, that's not what seven is. Seven is seven things. So I want students to understand that when they're showing seven, it's not just the digit. It's seven things. And so on a number path, we encourage kids to circle seven things when they're showing seven. This also leads into, you can do comparison type problems where kids will show an amount and then show the other amount and talk about, you know, which one is more, which one is less. And then that can lead into questions like, how much more, how much less, which is the precursor to building in this idea of adding and subtracting. So when kids are adding and subtracting using a number path, the one thing I want you to know, you don't need to teach them how to show it on the number path. It's up to them. The number path is a model. It's a tool for them to use. There is no specific way a child needs to show their thinking on a number path. The one thing I do want them to do is to show their thinking. And I should be able to look at the number path and tell what they did. So if we were solving a problem like 7 plus 8, and I wanted them to show their thinking on a number path, I would not want them to just circle 7 and then circle 8 things and tell me it's 15, unless they just knew 7 plus 8 was 15. But if they had some kind of thinking strategy, whether they counted 1 by 1 by 1, then they would circle 1 by 1 by 1 to show me what they did. But if they had a thinking strategy similar to something like, okay, I know 7, and then 3 more would make a 10, and then another 5 more gets me all the 8, that is what I want to see on the number path. However they thought about the problem, I want them to show that thinking. And then eventually the cool part is we can add in the symbolic piece as well, that abstract numbers, and attach it to the picture that they made with their number path. Now, I'm going to show you an example with subtraction, because subtraction always seems a little funky for people. People are a little unsure how to show subtraction. But the big idea, let's say we're doing 14 minus 6. The big idea for students to understand that we want them to get around subtraction, I want them to understand that we have 14. So somehow I want them to notate that they had 14. They might circle 14, they might put a star above the 14, they might put a little line after the 14, somehow to notate that that's what we started with. And then if they thought about 14 minus 6 as 14 and I'm gonna take away 6, somehow I want them to show me how they took away 6. If they took away 6 1 by 1 by 1, then that's what I want them to mark off on their number path. But if they took away 6 all in one fell swoop, then I want them to show that on their number path. Again, remember, it's just all about how are they thinking about the problem. That's what I want to see. So once they've taken away the 6, then somehow I need to know, like, where's your answer at in this, right? How do I know what's left? And there they show that there. And again, they could show it in lots of different ways symbolically or with the abstract symbols. Some of the kids might see that as 6 plus something gave me 14, or they might think of it as 14 minus 6 gave them the 8 that was left there. So it's all about helping them to use the number path to model their thinking. It's not about how we would use the number path. It's not about our strategy for using the number path. It's a tool. It's a model to help them show what was happening in their brain. All right, so to wrap this up, the best way on how to use a number path is to just let the kids use it. Let them show you their thinking around things about numbers and quantities and comparing and adding and subtracting, and then help them attach that to the concrete if they're actually counting out blocks, and attach it to the symbolic symbols and the abstract nature of mathematics. Use the number path as that representational piece when you're working with kids in kindergarten and first grade. Even preschool kiddos can be using number paths. At about partway through first grade, we want to start moving towards a number line and helping kids see the connection between a number path and a number line, But before that point, it's all about helping them see the individual objects and build their number sense and their understanding of addition and subtraction. So don't forget to get your download underneath this video, or you can go straight to buildmathminds.com to buy some pre-made ones and let the kids start writing on them and showing their thinking. I hope that this has helped you build your math minds as you go out and build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.